this passage. And last time, we began to look at the opening 12 verses, which is Luke's treatment of the resurrection of Jesus. And as I said last time, and as we will see this evening, there is one in Matthew, Mark, and John. All four gospel writers speak about the resurrection because the resurrection of Jesus is essential truth. In fact, without the resurrection of Jesus, there is no Christianity. The resurrection of Jesus is not the epilogue to the story of the life of Christ. It was the goal of his life. The resurrection, you see, is the divine interpretation of the death of Christ. It is the divine vindication of the work that he did on the cross. Without the resurrection, the cross means nothing. But when God raised Jesus from the dead, he was affirming and validating and vindicating the fact that he was indeed born our sins in his own body on the cross and had satisfied the justice of God with his sin bearing. So without the resurrection, the cross is meaningless. It's just another death. So the resurrection is everything and is the great reason for the gospel. The purpose of the gospel is not just that we might experience the forgiveness of sin. The purpose of the gospel is that we, having been forgiven of our sin, could enter into eternal life and live in the bliss of heaven forever in perfect holiness and joy in glorified physical resurrection bodies. That is the Christian message. The Christian message is that Jesus Christ rose from the grave in a glorified physical body, and that one day we who are followers of Christ, we will receive a body like his, and we will live in bodily resurrected form through all the eons of eternity. That, friends, is the Christian message. That is our hope, isn't it? Now, listen to the importance of the resurrection in the language of the Apostle Paul. In fact, I could have given you loads of stuff even before we get to the actual passage, but let me just show you how important the New Testament speaks, how it sees the importance of the resurrection. So Paul, in 1 Corinthians 15, 13 and 14, he says, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. So therefore, if Christ has not been raised in bodily form, then all gospel preaching is a complete waste of time. It is useless. In fact, it means that the whole of the New Testament is useless because that's where the first gospel preaching took place. There is no Christianity without the resurrection. So these idiots who are ordained ministers deny the resurrection, well, they're a waste of space in my book because they are talking rubbish. Without the resurrection, Christianity doesn't work. Verses 15 and 16, Paul says, more than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And we have no Christianity. We are to be pitied, basically, aren't we? Those who name the name of Christ. And what we've been preaching is a lie. It is a deception. Verse 20, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. If Christ isn't raised, there is no New Testament to be believed. There is no preaching about Christ to be believed. Your faith is worthless. But we know he has been raised. He is alive. So little wonder then that the four Gospels deal with the resurrection. They cover this monumental, unparalleled event. And we give a lot of time to the cross, and rightly we should, but it is the resurrection that vindicates the cross. In fact, the book of Acts records the history of the preaching of the resurrection. As the apostles and as the other preachers went out preaching, not just Christ crucified, but they preached that Christ is alive. They preached the resurrection of Jesus, that he rose from the dead, very importantly, in physical form. And so shall those who put their trust in him. The New Testament letters, in fact, follow the book of Acts, and they give us the explanation and the implications of the resurrection. In other words, what it means and how to understand the resurrection, how to apply that great reality in our own life. In fact, the book of Revelation closes the New Testament, and it tells us that we are going to be in our risen form in the glories of the new heaven and the new earth that will be established by the risen Christ. So it's quite important if you haven't worked it out by now. Now, as we look at the four gospel accounts of the resurrection, I want you to understand that there is, in those accounts, a harmony. So, as I said last time, this isn't something contrived that some committees didn't sit down and said, well, we've got these four different records here, and we need to sort of tie these things together and make them precise, or somebody's going to question the validity of them. That doesn't happen. No, there is a wonderful natural component to these gospels, so that each writer writes out of their own experience with the Spirit of God guiding their words and his own understanding of the event, and it's natural, it's personal. And at the same time, there is a harmony here. Each of the writers have their own emphasis, but they feature elements of the resurrection that are unique to them, but they all agree on the same truths. And they are critical to the verification of the resurrection. And there are four main truths that we're going to look at. We looked at two last time, and we'll look at the other two this evening. But let me review the last two just to remind you of what we looked at. And these are really important because these are the four great evidences of why the resurrection happened, to prove it, if you like. First one, on your outline. Number one, the empty tomb. The empty tomb. Let's look at our text. Here it is, verse 1. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. Now, the women are identified in verse 10. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them. Mark 16:1, by the way, names one other of them, Salome. Probably there was about half a dozen women, maybe some more. And the reason they came was that they were at the cross, remember. They were standing there watching Jesus while he was dying in stunned silence. And if you go back to Luke 23, they're also there when Jesus was buried. Verse 55, the women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph. Remember, Joseph of Arimathea, who had taken Jesus' body to bury him in his own tomb, in which nobody had ever been placed, and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. So, really important, they had seen the death of Christ. They saw him die. They were there when the soldiers didn't break Jesus' legs because he was already dead. And we know that because they, just to confirm that, the soldiers pierced his side and with a spear, and blood and water came out. They were there when he was buried as well, remember. And they saw Nicodemus show up with his spices and myrrh and aloes to put on the body of Christ as a testimony to his own love for Christ. Now, they determined that they weren't going to be outdone by this, by these men, by Joseph and Nicodemus, up to now secret disciples. So, verse 56, then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. Now, remember, Jesus was put on in the grave on Friday. They went home, these women. They had a few hours before the Sabbath begins, and so they went back and they prepared spices, because you couldn't do it on the Sabbath. You couldn't work on the Sabbath, remember? Can do that. Well, they're now ready to bring those spices back on Sunday when the Sabbath was now over. Very early in the morning, they were going to go there to anoint the body of Jesus as an expression of their affection for him. It is now dawn on Sunday morning. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Now, remember, as we saw last time, they were discussing what they were going to do when they got there, because they were saying, well, how are we going to remove this stone? This is a huge stone in front of this tomb. How are they going to do that? Well, to their shock, when they arrived, the stone was rolled away from the tomb. And when they entered, they did not find the body of Jesus. Now, to put the story together, the women are probably all connected to places in Bethany, which is about 2 miles away. And in the morning, it appears that Mary Magdalene and one other Mary, Mary the mother of Joseph and James, the wife of Clopas, they start out together according to the other gospel records. The other women are trailing behind. Mary Magdalene is assumed to be the youngest of them all, and she gets there first. According to John 20, she arrives while it's still the dark side of dawn. And she's alone when she gets there, because John says she goes through the dark. She looks through the dark, and she sees that the stone is rolled away, and she draws one immediate conclusion. Not that Jesus is risen. Oh no, she concludes that somebody has stolen the body of Jesus. She doesn't go in the tomb, interestingly. She doesn't go and look for the other women. She just turns and heads back. Now, on the dark side of dawn, the other women didn't see her. Maybe she went another way back. We don't know, because there's probably lots of ways to go back. But she heads back. John tells us she is making a beeline to get back to the apostles, to Peter and to John, to tell them that somebody has stolen the body of Jesus. And according to John, that's what she does. She's drawn that conclusion. She had no expectation of a resurrection. In fact, nobody did. None of the women did. She didn't. The apostles didn't. No one did. Which is a sad state of affairs, isn't it, really? How many times did Jesus tell them that was what was going to happen? And so, therefore, Peter and John, then, in response to her message, to say, look, that someone's stolen the body of Jesus, they decide, well, they've got to go check it out. They've got to go and have a look. So they head to the tomb. They run off straight away to go to the tomb. Well, probably before Mary ever got to them, the other women arrive, and that's where we are here in the story now. Everybody with me? So we've got to get this timeline in our minds, okay? The other women, well, they're a little bit more patient than Mary Magdalene, because they've tried to discern what's gone on here, what's happened. And so Luke says they entered the tomb, verses 2 to 3. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And what they did find was the grave clothes lying in perfect place, as we learn later, because the testimony of Peter and John tells us that. The women have no idea what's happened. Nobody does. Matthew tells us what's happened, actually, in his gospel, because he says in the dark of the night, Matthew 28, 2 to 4, it says that a Roman guard was placed there. The Jews, remember, went to Pilate and they said, look, we want a guard there. We want someone to guard the tomb, because we're afraid somebody will steal the body and the deception will be worse than the first deception. So we need to guard the tomb so that no one tries to steal it and pretend that there was a resurrection. So a guard was placed there for security in the dark of night. And I think this is so cool, because sometime in the darkness of the night, Matthew 28, verses 2 to 4 says this. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were as white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. Well, you would, wouldn't you, I think? They basically almost, they sort of fainted into sort of like a semi-coma, I suppose, out of sheer terror and shock. And remember, these are hardened soldiers. These were killers. They were that sort of people. But they are absolutely terrified. But they remembered what they had seen up to that moment. Well, when they finally woke up and the angel was no longer there and the stone was still rolled away, well, they must have looked in to check, mustn't they? They too saw the wrappings lying there, and immediately, still in the dark of night, they headed for the Jewish leaders. And when they got to the Jewish leaders, it says in Matthew 28, verses 11 to 15, they told them exactly what had happened. It says, we were there, we had a place guarded, we were there, had it all secure, you know, we're not messing about here. And all of a sudden there was this horrendous, severe earthquake. It must have been a very localized earthquake, because the Jews make no comment about it. And in the midst of the earthquake, out of the sky comes this dazzling, blazing angel who pushes the stone away and sits on it. And we checked the tomb when we woke up and there was no body there. Now, this is important. The response of the Jewish leaders, notice this, verse 13, you are to say, his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. In other words, they say to them, you have to lie. You have to say, the disciples stole the body and we're going to pay you, we're going to bribe you, we're going to give you some money to lie. Question. Why do you invent a lie? Cover up the truth, don't you? I mean, here is the testimony of the Jewish leaders that there was a resurrection. It's ironic, isn't it? I mean, it's funny, I think, but, you know, they're saying, you see, it doesn't shock them because Jesus had the power of life, and they knew that. I mean, he had given sight to the blind, hearing to the deaf, he'd risen people from the dead, didn't he, and so on. So miracles had followed him every year through those 3 years of his public ministry. And they never denied his miracles. They knew they were dealing with a very powerful person. And they knew that when the soldiers told them what had happened, that's exactly what happened. Because they knew no one could steal the body. Not with a Roman guard outside it. So all they could do was cover it up. And in covering it up, they invented the lie that proved the resurrection. It's good, isn't it? Isn't it interesting they did not call for further investigation? We don't read that, do they? They go, oh, we better just check this out. No. They didn't say, what is all this about? Oh, what? An earthquake? And then a blazing angel came down. Now, we need to look into this more carefully, we think. We need to have a proper investigation. They didn't do any of that. Remember, they had the most at stake, didn't they? They were the ones who wanted Jesus dead. They had the most at stake if, in fact, he was alive. Don't you think they would at least check it out? Find out the reality? Well, they don't. It was obvious. You have an empty tomb. You have grave clothes lying in place where they were when they were around the body, and the body is gone. And by the way, nobody, if you're going to steal a body, not that I recommend it, but if you're going to steal a body, okay, nobody steals a body and then leaves the grave clothes neatly put together, do they? I mean, you get in there and you nick it and you run, don't you? I mean, that's what you do. You take it in the form that it's in and you just get out of there. You don't think, all right, I just fold this up nicely, do a little bit of ironing, make sure it looks lovely. No, none of that. And remember, the soldiers were guarding the grave, the tomb. They knew they had a resurrection. They knew there was no other explanation apart from a resurrection. So they say, well, we'll lie about that, and we'll bribe these soldiers to lie. By the way, I have to say, they have a lot more integrity than many of these stupid skeptics and liberal critics through the years who tried to say that the disciples stole Jesus' body. Even the Jewish leaders knew that wasn't true. That's why they invent the lie that the disciples stole his body. They never investigated anything. They never asked for an explanation. Never questioned the soldiers, because they never even questioned the resurrection. Now, the empty tomb is powerful evidence. They did not offer some lame theory. Well, Jesus probably fainted, and then he came out on his own. I mean, I've heard people say that. You read these so-called people that got all these letters after their name. What nonsense. Think about this. Think about this. A crucified man, not a crucified man, not someone who's been hanging on the cross for 6 hours and bleeding out of his open wounds, someone who so obviously is dead that they don't break his legs, they ram a spear into his side and blood gushes out of his heart, a dead body then peeled off of the cross, hauled off and put in a grave. You mean to tell me he felt better after a couple of days in there? And he woke up, stood up, walked over to a small opening with a massive stone across it, and from the inside had the strength to push the stone away, bearing in mind he'd been crucified on the cross. Ludicrous, isn't it? Oh, and by the way, he left all his grave clothes there. I mean, seriously. See, they knew. They didn't even suggest such a stupid idea. And they knew that the soldiers had checked the tomb to make sure he wasn't there. And I'm sure the soldiers gave the testimony about the grave clothes that was so convincing. Actually, that's what convinced John later on, the empty tomb. When he gets there, he sees the empty tomb and the grave clothes lying there right where the body would have been. So the first line of evidence that all the four gospel writers want us to understand is the tomb is empty. There is no explanation except a resurrection. Number two, second line of strong evidence is the angelic messengers. And it's the revelation from the angels that's really important. It's the testimony of the angels. Remember, angels are seen as messengers in the Bible. They are many things. Funny how Sarah and I were talking about angels, as you do, yesterday. And I might just study on angels. It's fascinating, isn't it? Without getting too carried away by it. Because there's lots of funny ideas about angels and stuff. But one of the things that they are is that they are messengers. Look, here it is, verses 4 to 7. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Now, this is really important evidence because this is divine revelation. Two angels come down from heaven from God with the truth, and they declare to the women that Jesus is risen. He is not here. So you have the empty tomb, and you have the message of the angels to verify the resurrection. So you have evidence from the facts, and you have evidence from divine revelation. Now that brings us to the third and fourth lines of evidence that the gospel writers give us. Because the third thing is the witness of the women. The witness to the women. See, in response to the angels reminding them that Jesus had told them he would be delivered to sinful men, that he would be crucified, and then on the third day rise again. Verse 8 we read, then the women, they remembered his words. Now, it was at least on three separate occasions that Jesus told them what would happen to him, that he would rise again on the third day. And now it's beginning to make sense. The angels bring them a revelation they can't deny. And they know that they are angels. That's why they fall on their faces and bow down in terror before these holy beings. They are very clear that these are angels. They know that. And they hear the message from God. They remember the connection with what Jesus promised. And now they're starting to get it. And then they return from the tomb. And they turn, remember, and they take off. And where are they going? Verse 9. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. By the way, notice all of the men here. Where are they? Oh, they're hiding. They're afraid. The men are afraid. Now remember, Peter and John, back to our timeline now, okay? Peter and John are on the way to the empty tomb because Mary's already gone back, Mary Magdalene, and told her story that somebody stole the body. So now, these women are now beginning their journey. They have a different story than Mary Magdalene, don't they? Mary never looked in the tomb, remember? She never saw the grave clothes. She never saw the angels. She got wrong information. These women have the right information. So they start back, verse 9, but wait a minute before we get all excited. Something's happened on the way. And this is really cool. Matthew, we've got to go to Matthew 28. Well, I'm going to move around Gospels. You should know this. 28 verse 8. So the women hurried away from the tomb afraid. Well, you would be. They remember being in the presence of holy angels, yet filled with joy. Because they're beginning to get it now, aren't they? It's beginning to get clear to them. And they ran to tell his disciples. Now look at this, verse 9. Suddenly, Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. In other words, good morning, ladies. I mean, that's what it means. I mean, and I just love the simplicity of that, don't you? I mean, there's no wow factor here, is there? It doesn't say the earth shook and the sky parted and the stars fell and the angels blew the trumpets. It just says, Jesus says, morning. Good morning, ladies. Wonderful, isn't it? They came to him, clasped his feet and worshipped him. So now they've seen, remember, very importantly, the women, they have seen the empty tomb, they have heard the angelic revelation, and they have now seen the risen Christ. Verse 10, then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid, because their joy has gone back to fear. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, there they will see me. They're going to see me, says Jesus. In fact, they're going to see me in Galilee, they're going to see me before that, but I want them to be in Galilee, because there's going to be a big meeting there. And that's exactly what happened later on. So the women, they're on their way. They're going to tell the 11. And by the way, that is now the official title for the apostles, now that there aren't 12 of them. Remember, instead of being called the 12, there's no Judas anymore. They're now called the 11. Actually, there's only 9 of them there, because remember, Peter and John are on the way to the tomb. So the women, as they head back, they've seen the risen Christ. Now, what an experience that must have been, eh? Now, the question is, well, isn't it sort of odd that the women are the ones who are the initial witnesses of the appearance of Jesus? Is that for the sake of elevating women? Remember the time that they were in? Well, it certainly does do that, but that's not the primary reason. How many apostles were standing there watching Jesus being crucified? One. It was John, wasn't it? The Apostle John. But that's not enough, remember? Because if anyone is going to give testimony to the truth, going back to Old Testament law, it has to be confirmed by 2 or 3 witnesses. Well, where were the apostles? Well, they were big chickens, weren't they? Because they just ran away and they were hiding. Now, this is a wonderful testimony to the love and the courage of the women, and to the dignity of women, actually. But more than that, this is the same little group of half a dozen or so that saw Jesus die, remember? They saw Jesus buried, and they saw Jesus risen. And therefore, they are the only ones who are the credible eyewitnesses to the resurrection. We don't have any men who saw Jesus die, except John. We don't have any men who saw him buried, which was a confirmation of his death. And it has to be the women, because they are the eyewitnesses of everything else. And you can't have a resurrection unless you have a death and a burial. And you have to give testimony to the real death, the real burial, and the real resurrection. And these women, they have seen it all. So in verse 9, they report all these things to the 11 and all to the others. Because you've got 9 remaining from the 11, and you've got some other believers who were there. A couple of them actually appear later on the road to Emmaus. So, come back to Luke 24, verse 10. This is really interesting. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. Now, there's a little problem there. Have you spotted it yet? Here's the problem. What do you mean it was Mary Magdalene? How did she get in this group? Because the last thing we heard about Mary Magdalene, remember, was that she went there, saw nothing but an empty grave, came back with the wrong information. Because up to now, as far as we know, she hasn't come to the conclusion that Jesus is risen, apart from the fact she just thinks that somebody's stolen Jesus' body. She's told Peter and John her conclusion that somebody stole the body, which sent them on their way back to the tomb. How does she get into this little group then? Well, Luke is condensing the story, okay? So, I'll tell you how she got into this group. Turn to John chapter 20. I think this is really wonderful. How could she belong to these group of eyewitnesses when she didn't go in the empty tomb and she didn't hear the angels say anything? Because remember, she left before the angels appeared, didn't she? And she's not seen the risen Christ. So how can she be one of these witnesses? Well, the answer is, she went back to the tomb. At some point, she decides she's got to go back. And this is what John tells us she does. In John 20, verses 11 to 12, we find her standing outside the tomb, weeping. She's all alone, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. Remember, they're sitting on the inside here. These are two different scenes at two different times. There is one when they're outside, sitting on the stone that's been rolled away. And now this is, if you like, a private viewing for Mary. Verse 13, they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." So she's still sticking with her theory, isn't she, at this point? Verse 14, at this she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realise that it was Jesus. Why? I have no idea. Maybe she couldn't see through her tears, perhaps. But then nobody after the resurrection of Jesus could really know who he was until he actually revealed himself. That was true of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. And Jesus asked her the same question. Look at this, verse 15. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it that you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him and I will get him." That's a really stupid thing to say, isn't it, Mary? Seriously. I mean, how many gardeners go around nicking bodies? I mean, seriously. I mean, why? Why would she think the gardener would steal the body? And then I love this. Verses 16 and 17. Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And then she grabbed him. She hung on to him, probably on his feet and ankles. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God." Now, Mary, he says, "Look, you go. You go tell them you saw me. I am alive. But you can't keep me here. I'm going to ascend to heaven. I'm going to go back to the Father, but I'll meet you all in Galilee soon." And in fact, he met them there that very night and the next Sunday night as well. And in fact, many other appearances in the 40 days before he actually finally ascended to heaven. So he says to Mary, "You go." Verse 18, Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Now, did you get the picture? These women are there. They've arrived breathless from their encounter with Jesus on the way back. And they're saying to these nine disciples, these nine guys, look, we're telling you, we've got to tell you this, he's alive. We saw him, he said, good morning, ladies, and we had a conversation with him, and we saw the angels, and the angels told us that he was alive, and exactly what he said he would do, and he did it. And these nine guys are going, whoa, hold on a minute, just slow down, one at a time. I mean, you can imagine the excitement, can't you? I mean, you would, wouldn't you? And the wonderful truth is they're all saying the same thing. They don't need to kind of put their stories together, but they must have been breathless. And imagine, in the middle of all this, these women are going, whoa, all this sort of stuff. And then in bolts Mary Magdalene, and she's been running, and she's breathless, and she's, I've seen the Lord. And she starts telling them what he said to her. She has now had a private audience. She's seen the empty tomb and the grave clothes. She's heard an angelic revelation. She's had a personal experience of the risen Christ. So therefore, she had the same experience all the other women had, and she can be included by Luke in chapter 24 as one of the eyewitnesses of the risen Christ. All these women are giving testimony to the same thing. These are multiple eyewitnesses. And this is just the beginning, actually, because Jesus appears to two disciples on the road to Emmaus, as we'll see next week. Peter saw him in a private appearing. He appears to the 11 minus Thomas, and then a week later he appears to the 11 with Thomas. He appears to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. Then he appears to 500 at one time in Galilee. Then he appears to James. Then he appears to the 11 in the mountain in Galilee, where he gives them the Great Commission. Then he appears in Jerusalem at the time of his ascension. There are many, many, many eyewitnesses to the risen Christ. One final line of evidence. Number four, the unbelieving disciples. Now, he might say, hold on a minute, how on earth does that prove the resurrection? Well, it proves the resurrection because they would not fabricate a resurrection because they didn't expect one, did they? You see, critics of the resurrection have said things like this, well, they stole the body and made it look like a resurrection. Well, we've blown that one out of the water already. Or they say, well, they had a mass hallucination. They wanted it so bad that they all hallucinated together that it had happened, which is completely nonsense, isn't it? They didn't want it so bad because they didn't expect it. They had no concept that it would happen. And this is really important, Luke 24:11. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. A little bit rude, isn't it, really? But that's what they thought of the resurrection. These women going on, they thought, well, a lot of nonsense. Just idle talk. Some kind of fable. What's wrong with these women? And no matter what, that all their stories are identical because they'd all had the same experience and it was fresh. Because it wasn't like there were weeks in between where they were sort of trying to get together so that they could get all their stories straight and all say the same thing. No. They all come in. And it doesn't matter that their stories had cohesion and consistency. The disciples, they thought the whole thing was absolute nonsense. And they would not believe them. See, the disciples didn't make up the resurrection because they didn't believe that there was going to be one. And Luke adds a little note about Peter, verse 12. Peter, however, got up. This is like a flashback now. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what happened. What do you think he was thinking? What do you mean wondering to himself what had happened? Maybe he was beginning to think, this is a resurrection. This is a resurrection. Now, when did Peter go to the tomb? Well, it was before Mary Magdalene had come back. It was before the full testimony of the women. That's why this is seen, verse 12, as almost like a bit of a flashback. See, the timeline's clear, actually, in John 20, verses 3 to 8. Peter leaves after hearing from Mary Magdalene. So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. And the other disciple, that's how John refers to himself in his humble way. Peter goes to the tomb with John and they're running. They're going to verify Mary Magdalene's story that somebody stole the body. Verse 4, both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Now, John is faster than Peter, which knowing Peter's personality, that was bound to annoy him, wasn't it, really? I bet it really got up Peter's nose, because he always wants to be the first, didn't he? So John's faster because he's younger. Verse 5, he bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Now he's a little bit more retiring and shy, is our John. He's trying to just process this. Verses 6 to 8, Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. Well, of course he would do, wouldn't he? He just blows past John, straight in there, no messing about. In he goes. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. The empty tomb and the grave clothes was all that it took for John to believe. Now remember, they at this point only have heard the testimony of Mary Magdalene. They hadn't heard from the other women. They left when Mary had told them to leave. In the meantime, the other women had come to the tomb. They saw Jesus, came back with the story that he was alive. So all they have, all John has, is an empty tomb and grave clothes, but that's enough for him. He knew the stone couldn't be moved from the inside by a dead Jesus. And he had seen him dead, he was there, he knew. There was no other explanation but that he had risen. And John believed. Verse 9, they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. But he understands it now. Verse 10, then the disciples went back to their homes. That's interesting, isn't it? I mean, I'm sure they didn't know what to do next. So they went home. John believed. Peter's still struggling when he goes home. Meanwhile, the women have these other 9 guys on their hands, and they're trying to convince them that this thing really did happen, and they're not buying it at all. Why are they so stubborn? Well, actually, Luke tells us in chapter 24, verses 13 to 32, which we're going to look at next week, these two disciples on the road to Emmaus, who are an example of what all of them thought. They don't believe the women's testimony. This is what they say, verses 21 to 24. We had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. So they're saying, look, the women told them he was alive, but they didn't buy that. They don't believe that. Even when their companions went to the tomb, that's namely Peter and John, who didn't see Jesus, they sent word back and say, hey, we went to the tomb, he may be alive, but we didn't see him. They're still processing this. They're on the side of believing it, but they're not fully convinced. And so this is a reflection of their stubborn unwillingness to believe until they see. Now, you know, we often fault poor old Thomas, don't we? I do feel sorry for Thomas sometimes. Because he didn't believe, did he? I mean, he's like the bad guy of the piece, isn't he, really? Remember, he says, if I don't see the nails in his hands and where the spear went into his side, I won't believe. Well, do you know what? They're all as bad as each other, actually. They're all just as bad as Thomas, aren't they? They didn't want to believe the testimony of the women. And Peter and John come back and they say, well, it's a bizarre deal, really. The tomb's open, the tomb is empty, and the grave clothes are lying there. And, you know, he may be alive, but we're not sure. But they're not ready to fully commit. However, before the day is over, he appears to all of them. And the reason Scripture lays out the unbelief of the disciples is to dispel any ridiculous theories that they invented the resurrection because they wanted one so badly. That's just not the case. And that's why it always comes down to the issue of faith, doesn't it? See, facts are good. Facts deal with the historical barriers. And what these facts do, what these lines of evidence do, is dismiss weak arguments, foolish theories. But facts don't necessarily save someone. You might say, well, the facts look like he rose from the dead. And you'd be like one of the Jewish leaders, actually. And you ain't going to find many of those in heaven. Because they all agreed what had happened. They believed the facts. That's not going to save you. Or your feelings about the resurrection. And even the facts of the resurrection won't save you. The only thing that will save you is faith in the resurrection. Paul tells us in Romans 10, verse 9, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's where some real certainty comes from. Faith embraces the truth concerning Jesus Christ. So here's the thing. Next time somebody says to you, how do you know Jesus is alive? How do you know Jesus lives? Well, you can say, number one, the facts indicate that he is alive, and therefore that removes my intellectual barriers. Number two, my own experience of him in my life removes my emotional barriers. But more importantly than that, I have a faith that was given to me by God himself that has certainty and assurance. It It isn't the feelings that deliver the certainty. It isn't even the facts that deliver the certainty of the resurrection. It is the faith that delivers the certainty. So therefore, ask God to give you that faith that makes the resurrection certain. Let's pray together. And our Father, it is a glorious message. It is the wonderful truth that our Lord Jesus Christ is alive. And we recognize that if it wasn't for the resurrection of Jesus, then it tells us that we one day will not be resurrected. We have no hope. But we thank you that because Jesus is alive, we who trust in him will one day be alive in full resurrected bodies. And our Father, we want to thank you for that amazing, wonderful truth. Lord, as we come around the Lord's table in a moment, we come around the Lord's table in the knowledge that Christ died, but Christ is risen. And so, Father, we pray that as we spend time reflecting on our great salvation, of all that Christ has done for us, please remind us of these wonderful truths. Thrill our hearts.